Only one army battalion, the 27th battalion all over Mindanao. And the task force pagkakaisa, they told us that in this area we have 4,000, in this area like this, so many thousand all armed. In my mind, I said, we better go home. 4,000. I said, how can we? These people, to them it is 4,000, so on. No? Well, anyway, in the area we were sleeping again on tables at the headquarters, PCL. We were sleeping on tables, on chairs. We have nothing. We have no support element except for the PC, except for the 5 upas. We're there. That very night, it was in Cotabato City, there's war. That same evening, in fact, the following evening, I had to distribute grenades to everybody because there were no firearms. I had only 138 caliber and some pistols. The PC, they have theirs, but then it was only the PC Hill that we were holding. And that very night, I distributed grenades. I got a can of grenade, a box of grenade. I said, hey, kapag umakyat dito, hulugan tayo ng granada. Officers started coming in, and they were there to augment our headquarters. They came with shotguns from Cebu. The following morning, civilians were plucking in the area, asking for firearms, this and that, because they'd like to arm themselves also, the Christians. Now, it so happened that was in 1972 when martial law was declared. All firearms were supposed to be surrendered. And what happened there? The Christians surrendered their firearms. So many. In fact, in that PC camp, you can see a stockpile of pugakang, we call them. This shotgun made out of pipes from Iloilo. And these are the arms of the farmers in the area, Christian farmers. And there was a stockpile of that. And here comes the civilian asking for firearms. Personally, I said, hey, you look for those things there. You pick up anything you can pick up, all the shotguns. And that's how we were armed at the time. We were a ragtag group, starting from year 1973. Before that time, we were in the Visayas region, with the 3rd Infantry Brigade separate, and we had nothing here, but we were organizing and dealing on several assistance and several action work. Since Visayas at the time was very peaceful, and we were training some first class, second class, until class trainees for the area. The unit, army unit in the area was the 3rd Infantry Brigade separate under the command of then Colonel Fortunato U. Abad. At the time, I was the 3 operations officer of the brigade here in the Visayas. And to start the Mindanao conflict, it was on 5 March 1973 when Jolabat received a call from President Ramos ordering him to field all our forces to Mindanao, in Cotabato particularly. At the time, that was in March, of course, 1973, we had only 3 companies here in the Visayas. We had one in Hamindan, that is in Panay. We had one 3 company in Kampion Kilat, that is in Negros. One in Ormoc, another 3 company, and we had one here in Cebu City. With that instruction, early in the morning of 3 March, I was instructed by then Colonel Abad to assemble our forces, of which I called up all the units in Panay, in Leyte, and Negros to assemble. In Leyte, from Ormoc, they took the barge the ferry from Ormoc to Cebu that same day. In Negros, they took the ferry from Negros to Cebu that same day to send these troops to Mindanao that same day. So as soon as they were assembled here, we sent ahead the battalion headquarters by plane, and that was already late in the afternoon. All the others were ferried to Cotabato City by by C-47 and by PAL planes. We were able to send them, the whole battalion, the three rifle companies, the headquarters company, the battalion headquarters, to Cotabato the same day. We stayed in the airport and we issued by them. While they were boarding the plane, the trainees, the Niverso and M16 at the time, we had a few, so while they were boarding, we gave them 16. We were able to finish it late in the evening, and they were ferried to Cotabato by PAL and C-47. They landed in Cotabato airstrip by using lanterns to guide the planes coming in. We slept in Mactan because it was late. But the following day, that same evening, Colonel Awat reported to President Ramos, Marcos, and told him that, sir, we deployed one battalion already. So we came back to Cebu here in mainland Cebu. We didn't have any sleep. I was here in my quarters sleeping. So right here in Cebu, I organized the Sikan Brigade of the 3rd, we call it. We trained and prepared for employment. It was employed in Mindanao. I became a deputy brigade. So we were employed as a brigade. All raw, without any experience, all the boys and so on. But then we were able to survive. Late in the afternoon, my phone was ringing. And it was General Abad, or Colonel Abad at the time. Very short, he just told me, you have 1 hour. We're going to Mindanao. Because he was called by President Ramos to take command of all forces in central Mindanao. So, Colonel Abad, Colonel Harkey, Lieutenant Colonel Harkey at the time, who was our intelligence officer, myself, who was the operations officer of the brigade, his aide-de-camp, Lieutenant Gloria, as his admin officer at the time, and his side boy, his orderly. The five of us live for Cotabato. And he was told that there's a plane waiting for us at the Mactan airstrip. When we arrived at Mactan, it was already almost dark. And on board was General Bueno of the Air Force. And it was a PAL plane that brought us to Cotabato. So we flew to Cotabato after that, and I requested, in fact, General Bueno of the Air Force, if we can have a reconnaissance of the area, because for myself and General Abad and the others, we never had a chance to be in Mindanao at the time. Our first time to be in the area. Anyway, General Bueno said that it's already dark, we cannot do that. We landed in Cotabato using only lanterns to guide us to land. We slept in the PAL makeshift at the time. It was not the one we have now. We slept on the floor because we cannot go to the city. It was too dangerous. It will take so many minutes, and it was an ambush site. So we slept there. We jelabat sleeping on his sofa, well, so on the floor and so on. And the worst thing that happened is that evening we were there, there was one shot. And everybody, all the Air Force and so on, you know, they were nervous. It was a shot from a guard who thought that somebody was coming in, and he fired. So actually the whole chunk of mainland Mindanao was under Simcom, except for the two Sambuanga provinces, Surigao and the Agusan provinces. We organized, and he gave his briefing. He told everybody that I am going to be the commander here, and all forces is supposed to be under my command. So the PC, all of the PC except the headquarters, were under the army. Jelly Spina, who was then his classmate for PC son, was already complaining because his area was only the headquarters in Parang. In other words, administratively, the PC were under the PC, but operationally, they were all placed under Simcom, including the Air Force and the Navy in the area. The operation was how to secure the bridges and how to rescue the PC that were surrounded. First, the Simuay. There were 20 or so. Simuay Bridge, 20 or so PC people there that were there for 7 days already, and they cannot get out because they were surrounded. We didn't have the forces. The PC had some armored cars, two armored cars in Cotabato City. Well, again, I would say, like to say I, because we were the only army people there. We were inside the PC camp, PC Hill. I had to look for people to rescue. We seen an armor car, mamaya wala na iwan. Patay lahat kasi mga sniper. The second armor car, pumunta doon, nakabalik. The caliber 50, nobody can fire already because the gunner namatay. So I had to shout in the camp, who knows how to fire a caliber 50 machine gun? And there was one, and he was a radio operator of the PC. He volunteered. We seen him, the poor fellow. He came back without, without an eye. He was just a radio operator of the PC. He volunteered. We were able to rescue the 20 so PC in Simuay Bridge. And also, this time, it was Libak that started the whole thing. By the way, I did not see and hear how this thing started. Sometime in April, February, late February, 10 fishermen were killed by the MNLF in Libak, in Tran especially, because they found out that these 10 fishermen, Christians, were able to go near their encampment in Tran. Now the problem is going to Marawi. Now the Port ID, their brigade, was told also to meet us in Masyo while we were pushing this way. Adalim was given a mission to follow the road towards Masyo. And Masyo crossing towards Butig. 11th IB, I gave them the mission to be up on the high ground. And the first unit to move was supposed to be the 33rd IB. But I don't know, I changed my mind. I let the 11th IB move ahead. So this is the lake, this is the road, like that. The 11th IB here. The 33rd was supposed to follow the road up to Masyo, Butig like that. But 11th, the mission was here towards Butig. So instead of this moving ahead, I let this move ahead. Change. If not for that, pack souls prepared, ready to hit us. In fact, there were two tank traps across the road. Talagang hinukay, Parang nakadaan ng tangke saka with explosives. But then, tumakbo sila kasi yung batalyon na isa nandito sa likuran ng 11. Hindi nila alam na mayroong batalyon dito bago pumasok kami 33rd. However, in the last gabi, we slept on the road. We walk with the time. It was then the deputy of Joel Abbott, Simcom, was Joel Castro. He's one fellow who's a field man. He was with me. We sleep on the ground also there, and we follow the battalion like that. The 33rd IV, Joel Adalem, was lucky. They sleep last portion that they occupied. The following day, they were supposed to go through, because I said, you better occupy that high ground. That is an ambush alley. Nahuli siya, paglagay ng butas. His lead company, well, poor fellow is dead already anyway. May dala kami mga dump truck ng WP highways eh. Pinag-commander ko lahat yan eh. Pati scoop loader. Sinakay niya sa dump truck yung company niya to move ay 500 meters away from the last position, ambushin sila. Ubus. 32 killed in action, including the company commander. General Daling was supposed to join them. Nahuli lang kasi sabi niya, nahuli ako pag kuha ng butas ko. Otherwise, patay siya doon. The grand design, as we found out later in some intelligence job, was for Cotabato to be the base. With this force, they'll take the city, the airport, Parang, and they will swing towards Bukidnon, Agusan, and Surigao. While somewhere in Lanao, the Sambuanga people will get Sambuanga Peninsula, and the Solo people will get Solo, and the whole will be under. And that's very true. If not for Simcom and the decision making made by President Marcos, we could have lost Mindanao. And initially it was the Visayan people who were there to really help, because they were the first group of army soldiers who were sent to Mindanao. All officers of the brigade then, the Bichon, most of them went there, and arriving with shotgun and Paltic. I can remember Colonel Garcia, who was made the U1 of Simcom. You know, his class, class in Garcia and PMA. Anyway, he was handling his Paltic like this. Mamaya, nahulog, it dropped. Pumutok. So we thought we were already infiltrated inside the camp. And it was the Paltic that he brought his only firearm going to Mindanao to fight the war. And that was how it was at the time. If you touch them, we did not touch them because they were not touching anybody. Wala pang gulo eh. So pinabayaan. That was the mistake. Kaya pumutok. And they were ready. There was a tip of the balance. The Christians, wala nang baril. Nung araw, balance eh, may gira-gira. But because of that, pumutok nga. And this was the group that first came in, and they were augmented by then the Kamagong Kampa Battalion. And this Kamagong Battalion actually, shall we say, mas hab-save Mindanao. And this was the concept of Jel Segala at the time. And these are composed of trainers. But then, these are ill-equipped, not properly trained, coming from the barrios. So that in the fight in Lebak, you can see one whole battalion withdrawing. Because they are all trainers. Leaving, I think, three mortars behind and so on. And I was able to interrogate one trainee. I asked, why were you running back? Sir, masyadong malakas. Saka, alam mo, these are the boys from the barrios and they believe so many things. Sir, hindi matatamaan ng bala. Putok ako ng putok ganun, ubos magasin ko, takbo na naman ako, nandiyan pa. Pero nang nabuwal ako, he stumbled, his M16 hit the ground. Ang dulo ng M16. Balik naman siya, ganun pala, sir. Ganun mo muna yung baril mo bago baril. So that was the type of soldier that we had at the time. Not properly trained, not educated, but ready to fight. And in that instant, he believed that you have to do like that so that the garden will drop. Sabi, ganun pala, sir. Ganun mo muna. Ball down tao eh. Tumatakbo siya. Well, that was the fighting and Libak collapsed. So we started with Libak. And in Libak, the way task force was created, task force Cosmos, no? And this is a group. First, there was a battalion. We called it CIB, Composite Infantry Battalion. And this Composite Infantry Battalion came from Manila, organized, composed of all Army, PC, Air Force, Navy, and was sent here. All regular soldiers, but coming from different services. And most of them are people who, you know, some of them from the, from those with, if you are in the unit, you'll send people who, whom they want to, like this. And we were on the airstrip of the Magsaysay Logging Company along the shoreline. Who was there was Colonel Ladimura, the famous Ladimura we had, and Ilonggo. He was the company commander. We were able to overrun Tran, the people surrendered, so on. That's where the Los Caman was created. Maybe you have heard of Los Caman. Again, that was the time when in the movie there was the Dirty Dozen. The movie Dirty Dozen, and these are, coming people that were really dirty. So the idea came to us that we will organize because Ladimura at the time was complaining, alam niya lugar, sabi niya, sir, doon sa taas, bundok, merong gap doon, hindi na yung sirkuluhan. That's where they are getting their food and so on. We need some forces to plug that. Wala na kaming force, so the idea came in that we will organize a group without any support. I personally asked Colonel Ladimura, who said at the time he was ranking than I was, how can we? Can we give you forces without even salary, without any food, no firearms? Can you produce these things in the area? He said yes. So what we did was to release all the soldiers that were in prison. That was not authorized at the time. From Dabao, Del Santos, all those in prison, we gave it to Ladi, and he was he organized that. We call him Ladi, and that was the Los Caman later. Because when we tried to disband this group, hindi naman disband. Hindi naman disband at the time, so they became Los Caman. I was the one also who drove them all the way to Dabao when I was the brigade commander. Anyway, that ended the Libak operation. I received a call that Carmin Town was burning. Carmin Town was burning. So the 32nd IV of Kanyiso was pulling out, going back to Midsayap. I contacted Colonel Kanyiso. I said, Rudy, I'll pick you up by helicopter. We'll go on reconnaissance to Carmen because I received a report that Carmen is being burned by the rebels. But continue with your pull out and go to Midsayap. We cannot cross the river in Lumayong, that is in Kabakan, towards Carmen because the rebels burned the ferry. There was no bridge at the time. There was a ferry. So we told Kanyiso
Instead of going back to Michayap, go direct to Kabakan with your company, with your battalion. The first company that arrived was under then Lieutenant Brillantes. We cannot cross because they were on the opposite side. There was no ferry and they were firing at us and so on. So personally, I told Brillantes, I said, I don't know how you do it, but you cross the river, you hook the enemy from behind so we can cross. The whole battalion can cross. And he did that. He went downstream, so with his company, crossed slowly, then hit the enemy from behind. We were able to cross the whole battalion. We walked all the way to Uldon, to Carmin. The half the town was in ashes. And who did it? It was the son of Dato Ogtog Matalam, Nuruddin Matalam, was the commander at the time. So we were able to get Carmin and save the people, the civilians. That was one of the brigade, major brigade operation. I went to the old man, Ogtod Matalam. You must have heard of Ogtod Matalam. He was really a leader. He's an old man, maybe uneducated, but he was a leader. I talked to him, I visited him, I said, Dato Sultan, pwede ba mag-surrender yan si Nuruddin? Anak niya man si Nuruddin. Nuruddin Matalam was his son. Pasurrenderin na natin. Because the brother, other brother, was our CHD commander at Lumayong. Lumayong is that crossing point of that river. John, who became a congressman, he was our CHD commander. But the other son was with the rebels, Nuruddin. The old man told me, he told me personally, I said, patayin mo yan na yan. Bakit patayin natin? Anak mo naman yan. Kasi that fellow, he's still alive, ano? Eh, lahat na baka na matanda, mga ganito. Nauubos, mga ganito. Galit din siya. Hindi, pasurrender natin. But the fellow surrendered to me. I enlisted him. Nuruddin entered Buldon. We surrounded Buldon and not a single shot was fired. True to fact, they all gang up ng Kanyiso in Langkong. And they're going back was very slow because they have to cross mountains. Well, in our case, we're following the road. So we are in Buldon and we influence Buldon. And the problem, there was no mayor and so on. We have to look for Mayor Aratok. We evacuated. We went to Lanausor. So they gave us a mission because Jel Abad received a letter from Buldon. He was told, you come here to Buldon, we'll fight the war here. So they picked the 2nd Brigade to go to Buldon. Well, at the time, we had only 2 battalions with us. The 27th Infantry Battalion, which was based in Kabakan, and the 32nd Infantry Battalion of Colonel Kanyiso, which was in Michayap, Israel Mission. He told me, oh, you go there and influence the area. Ako influence pala, hindi na kailangan gira. Anyway, we went to Parang, and I made the plans for Buldon, and it was a very classic one. Colonel Kanyiso at the time was given the mission to go towards Langkong, which is the Ramos Highway now, Ramos Highway, Langkong, while the 27th was in Bigkawayan, in Cotabato, to cross the mountain and they will meet something. But then initially, we pushed Kanyiso because we knew how the rebels were reacting. We pushed the battalion of Kanyiso towards Langkong. The idea then was to draw the forces from Buldon because that is their modus operandi there, the moment. Everybody will gang up on you. So Kanyiso, but I give a limit of advance to Kanyiso. Was then I said, by that time we will pull you back fast and we go to Boldon. Imagining that it was already vacuum. Now it was at that very time we cannot contact him by radio anymore because Kanyiso is one soldier who push and push. Actually, they actually Lichon. The troops. When I see Lichon, talagang Lichon. That is true, no? Well, anyway, Dato Piang was their seat. And there were so many pump boats along Rio Grande, all loaded with gasoline, food stuff, ready to move in to Cotabato City. And from Dato Piang and so on, so many vehicles were already ready to move in. That was their mistake. They killed this 10 people in Libak, and that one in crossing Salvo. That made President Marcos react, and we were able to come in. Otherwise, if they were able to really go without our coming in, they could have taken Cotabato City, the whole, the airport, and so on. But we were able to come in before they were even able to execute. Then the brigade was in the field with the troops. And we were there for 28 days, day and night, putukan yan. And that is where you will don't place it there, but that is where you see people being eaten by dogs, by so on. The soldiers cannot advance anymore because masyadong nang maamoy. Swampy pa yan eh. Complaining sila because maamoy na, ang, hindi na mapulot ang patay ng Eminelip. In fact, I ordered sacks of lime. Kaku, lagyan natin lime. Para mano, because already at the time, if you hit one, watch for that fellow. Bantayan ninyo. Kaya mayroong gagapag dyan, kukunin niyo. Because to them, we have to be buried within 24 hours. Saka gagapang yan. So, nakatatakpal, binabantayan sila. Pag nikam, bang. Meron na naman. Kaya hindi nila mapulot, hindi umamoy na ba. So, we cleared that area. Humingi ng 1 month, sabi niya eh. Wag, sabi niya 1 week. 1 week. Siya mismo nagsabi, kumisong datuan nung. Secretary by the way. Secretary na siya, yung Secretary of Justice. I said, okay, 1 week. I'll give you 1 week. After 1 week, my brigade will go through. So, please come out before the end. True to fact, the Rossi group that came out. 5 commandos. Pare official. Ay, nandodo niya rebuilde. Naka-purma. Nakalinya. Yung masingga nila, nasarap. Nakalagay ang belt kanon. Ako naman, at the time, I had Sterling. Ang baril ko ng Sterling eh. Nakabalabag yan dito. 5 commanders. So kung saan ako mupunta, yung caliber 30, gumaganon. So what I did was to inaup mo kaya 5 commander doon, dinakos kanila. Kako din magbabaril niya kasama commander nila. Eh. Anyway, that gave me an idea. I said, mahirap ito. Outnumbered lang kami. There were 7 of us only and there were 100 of them. Katarantaduan. Anyway, I told the 5 commanders, Kako, punta tayo doon, punta tayo doon. So I brought the 5 commanders with me. I sat on the ground para kaming Indian, yung pawaw na Indian. Noon, usap-usapan. 5 commanders sila, may carbine officers, may ano, Sterling. So there was a time na medyo tawanan na, may broke the ice. Na medyo nag-relax na kami, no? Kabalik tayo doon. Bumalik kami. So, we were able to negotiate and so on. Okay, Kako, okay, surrender kayo. You go back there because I'm going through. Sabi ng commander, sir, marami pa doon sa loob. Magdaan yung mag-surrender.
I said, I know there are some rebels here. And so on. But I have a mission. I have orders to go through this highway towards Balabagan o Plano Sur. So I said, kung pwede, pwede ba lumabas lang kayo? Kasi alam na niyo kung ano mangyari. Pag pumasok ako dyan, body said, pwede ba 1 month? Sinabi ko, Commissioner Dato, anong? Ayang Ramos Highway. I went through that, not firing a single shot. Almost 400 people surrendered to me there. Kasi kinausap, ang technique kasi iba eh. I took over the whole Plano Sur. Now that is where I met the Dimapuro clan. And up to now, I salute the old man, Dimapuro. They said he's like this, like that. Time that was already in Lanao Soran, he became the governor. Maganda ang usapan namin. Kasi alam mo, I know the Muslim, just like the Jack, if you are frank, diretso na salita. Saka if you see something, you mean it, do it, and they will respect you. That's why the chief of staff asked me, paano nyo nung paamo ito mga ito? Kako sir, pareho lang tayo sir eh. Pilipino din eh. Bisaya, pareho din tayo eh. Minsan yung kaibigan yan, women. Maranao women, parang nakakulong sa bahay. Hindi nakakalabas yan, hindi namamasal yan. A woman, Maranao woman, must not marry a Christian man. I have that experience. When I was the brigade commander, another one, teacher na Maranao, nag-complain sa akin yung mayor ng Lumbatan. Sabi niya, Colonel, yung sundalo mo, drafty, pero gwapo. Tagay, panay. Gwapo na drafty. Yung kunay, maestra namin, doon na natutulog sa kanya. Kako di kasalatin. Ay, di natin. Hindi pwede, hindi pwede. Kako na gagawin natin, gusto ng babae, di kasal. Later, bumalik sa akin. Sabi niya, pwede kasal natin para ikaw ang ninong, saka si gobernor. Kinasal namin. That was the time before I was pelded to Hulo. They were married. I learned later na pinatay nila ang sundalo. And the woman disappeared. Kasi lumayas, pumunta pa sa panay. Papatayin pati babae. Maranao. Maranao man can marry a Christian but not a woman marrying a Christian. Pati pamilya magagalit. Pati siya papatayin. So we organized the CHDF. That the first time CHDF was organized. And we were helped by the students of the Commandant General Staff College. At the time, it was stopped and they were all sent to us. With that group, no less than Secretary Ermita was there. We got him as our advisor on CHDF, on home defense. We have the Leon, we have the PC officers organizing the home defense forces. But then there were no firearms to be given. So, well, I told Jalawat, I said, we have some M1s in Visayas. Because the RTC then at Visayas were under the army. All RTC and they were armed with M1, except without firing pins. So all the grants of RTC units in Visayas were shipped to Cotabato to be given to the CDF. That's why no single firearm of here with the RTC. They're now using wooden rifle, no? Because that was brought to Cotabato to arm the civilian, to start, to have a force, small force at least, to hold some portions of the city. Because there was such a grand design, they said. Only to pan out later, he became the governor of Cotabato.
Well, anyway, at that time, well, I forgot to tell you that we divided North Cotabato at the time. Actually, when we arrived, it was Colonel Cahilo who was the governor. Colonel Cahilo was the old provincial commander, and he won the election. And North Cotabato was under him when we came. And it was big, big North Cotabato. I was given instruction by Jal Awat, being his chief of staff, to study the area and divide the province. That's how the Cotabato was divided. Well, I studied. And if you see the map, the old map of Cotabato now, there's another province anyway. The line there, the provincial division, that is my pencil. So we made three provinces, Sultan Kudarat, Maguindanao, and North Cotabato. Now the thing is, who will be the governor? North Cotabato, no problem, because Colonel Cahilo was the old governor. He was designated as the governor. Maguindanao was actually not purely, but so many percent Muslim. I studied, divided. That's why you will see paikot-ikot yung provincial, ano, because kung saan yung Muslim, in-include ko doon sa Maguindanao. The idea is more of a political and military strategy. That's why they have the armed now. So on.